Déjame, yo estoy desde el...
Ahora sí. Okay. Oh, yes. So, thanks to the organizers for the invitation. I am part of the organization, but the invitation comes from the other member of the group. So, thanks to you. In this occasion, I'm going to present one of the most recent work from our group in a joint experimental and theoretical methodology. This is the reason why the name is very complex or relatively complex. The title is Mixed Ionic Electron Transport for Crystalline P3HT with both explicit lithium dopant and DNA additive assessment using ab initio molecular dynamics. I'm going to explain a little more in detail regarding this work. This is a part of the work of the thesis of Dominique Monbrou, one member of our group, and the rest of the authors are the directors of the thesis. Okay, the motivation of this work lies in the one of the main goals of our research group, which Alvaro Monbrou is the head of the group. We are highly devoted performing theory and experiment for materials in energy applications, particularly in solar cells for energy generation, working with solar cells based on titanates, for example, for dye-sensitized solar cells. Two theses of our group are related to this topic. And more recently, dealing with polymeric solar cells, this is part of the thesis of Dominic. We have some previous work related to this from theoretical and experimental point of view, as I mentioned before. And in parallel, we are working with energy storage, particularly for Li-ion and Na-ion ion batteries, working mainly in solid state electrolytes based on polymers. This is the reason why we again trying to start describing or analyzing polymers in general and with forecast of two. So this is other relevant papers related to these methodologies, jointly methodology using experiment and theory, preparing our solar cells and modeling mainly based on titanates in general for solar cell application and for Li-ion batteries. Okay, but the title of the presentation is related to one particular conductive polymer. It is P3HT. It's a polyolefin. It's very common. Many of the applications of this conductive polymer lies on the fact that it can be easily prepared. For example, in a solution, you can dissolve your polymer, and using a spin coating technique, you can deposit on a glass, for example. And after a preparation that we are going to enter in details in a few slides, you can activate your system and the polymer can become conductive. It is a polymeric conductor, so the energy involved in the preparation, production, recycling, and so on offers many advantages in comparison to conventional conductors. For example, another interesting properties of this kind of polymers is it can be transparent and conductive. So many of the organic or polymer solar cells are based on this kind of polymers. For example, P3HT is this one. It's a polyolefin with a three ethyl group. This is a chain that gives, we are going to enter into details in a few slides. It enters some structural features which are relevant for the electronic properties or behavior of the system. So organic solar cells are mainly based on this polymer. It can be used for coatings, it can be used for sensors, it can be used in solid state electrolytes for batteries and so on. So many applications, and particularly polyolefin is one of the most famous and more convenient material to work with. But the polymer cannot be used as a raw material directly. It needs to be modified For example, it can be, it should be doped, positive doped, this semiconductor, so require doping. And we are going to enter in some few words related to the mechanism for the charge transfer mechanism in this kind of system. For example, the formation of dipolarons, proximity effects, and charge delocalization. So, how a polymer can turn metallic? As you know, when you are dealing with a metal, you have too many electron levels, very proximate in energy. So with very few EV, you can establish a mobility of your charge current along the valence and the conduction band. But you, when you are dealing with a semiconductor, there is a clear separation between valence band and conduction band. It requires a relatively high energy barrier. For example, between 0.1 and 3 eV, you will have a semiconductor, and if the energy gap is higher than that, you will have an insulator. When you have a polymer, for example, it is not polyurethane, but it can be easily extrapolated, you will have an insulator. So common polymers, in your home, you have a copper wire, it is recovered by a polymer. So the polymer is protecting you from the charge mobility from the metal. So how a polymer on this basis can be conducting? For example, you need to remove electrons, or you have to add electrons. When you are adding, for example, an electron, this is not our particular case, but this is the diagram that I selected to explain this mechanism. We are adding some impurity levels in the middle of the gap. If you are particularly adding one single electron and you want to charge the purity with magnetism, it is not the best place to have charge mobility in this situation. For example, you have to, or you are willing to perform a singlet situation. For example, adding two electrons or removing two electrons in order to pair these impurity levels this way. When you are an electron, one other important characteristic is the formation of a polaron. It's a polaron, it's a quasi particle in which an extra charge is accompanied with a lattice distortion. So anytime you add an electron or you remove an electron, you are inducing a local distortion of your structure, in any particular case, in the main charge of the polymer. So we need to, for example, remove two electrons who are two electrons. So in this case, you are forming a dipolaron. These situations are a little bit more stable, but in the situation in which the two extra charges become proximate, there is a charge instability, or energy instability, so the energy levels becomes different in energy. So in order to recover our idea of a metallic system in which too many levels being proximate in energy, we need to generate a degeneracy of these levels. So the way to do that is to put these charges separately. So due to the charge mobility or due to the charge localization at the overlap of the pi cloud established because of the carbonate of this system, it is easily to prepare to migrate this excess of charge. So your polaron now becomes separated. So because of that separation and the connection between of the charge localization, this essentially become aligned, so highly degenerate, I would say. And now our impurity level establishes a band due to this dipolaron, and will establish, for example, a solitude wave propagation. So a solitude is a wave packet that keeps its amplitude along the main chain. So, in order to get a polymer being conductive, you need to remove charge or add charge to your system. So this is the reason why it is important to perform DFT calculation or electronic starboard calculation to understand how to remove these charges, which element, which chemical to use in order to proceed with this mechanism. So N time and P doping is required. We need to establish a bipolar formation, and followed by a bipolar degeneracy in order to get the final situation in which the charge current establishes a high mobility along the main change, which is called usually called solid information. So, our particular polymer in which we are going to put our tension is P3HT, is poly-3-acyl theophene. Theophene is the main backbone. And this complex name, it's related to the modification of the backbone, or the main backbone of the poly-3-acyl. So P3HT is this one. So it is a highly crystalline polymer. It is important because polymers are not so crystalline. It can be a relatively crystalline in which the main backbone becomes aligned with more or less distortions, but it is not totally amorphous and it is not totally crystalline. But among all the common conductive polymers, P3HT is one of the most crystalline systems. The polythiophene establish a change in which the ordering is relatively high. So it's relatively stable chemically and thermally. So it's good for application, for example, and it presents a low band gap in comparison to other possibilities. It is transparent, I can say, as I mentioned before, it can be reduced or oxidized. And there are many, many applications in which two of them are related to the things I mentioned before. It's solar cell and batteries. So we are interested in a first approach in describing the role of crystalline domains and amorphous regions of this polymer, a local disorder in the backbone. Backbone is the main change of the polymer in which the charge transport mechanisms take place. The use of dopants, which dopants, where are they located? Usually in the bibliography, when dealing with TFT calculation, for example, it is usual to work only with only one change of the polymer. And in order to model the situation of the charge formation of the polaron or dipolaron, in the calculation, you are implicit dopant agent situation. This is just an addition or a total addition of one electron of the system, one, two, or removal, a remotion of two electrons or one electron. So you are removing electron from your system in order to simulate the situation of doping. So it is not very common to see the addition of a dopant agent in which the dopant takes the place of the reduction agent or the oxidation agent. So it is important for us to understand, at least at the chemical and the structural point of view, the role of this dopant of the system. So, and finally, how is the complete fixture of the system? So role of the disorder, role of the explicit dopants, and role of the additives. For example, we will see in the second part of this presentation how the addition of a small organic chemical species can give strong mobility of the change, the structure of the change of our polymer in order to increase, for example, the mobility of the Li ion of the system. So this is two of our models used for the current, for example, the crystalline system. It is based on experimental findings using X-ray diffraction, for example. As I mentioned before, this system, when we are saying that it is crystalline, it is mainly crystalline. There are domains that are highly ordered in the presence of other regions in which the situation is highly amorphous or highly disordered. So the real situation involves regions of this kind of system in presence of or regions close to this one with amorphous one. So in order to perform our situation in a best way, we are assuming the two separate situations, mainly crystalline and mainly amorphous. So in the part one, we are dealing with this, with crystalline versus amorphous P3HT. As I mentioned before, we will add one particular dopant, one famous dopant. It's very complex, its structure, I know that, but it's very famous because in many applications for Li-ion battery, for example, it provides as a Li-ion source in the system. It is easily dissolved on the matrix of the polymer. and the Li ion becomes then free to move in the middle of the matrix in order to increase its autodiffusion diffusivity. And the role of the dopant is very interesting to analyze, at least from the theoretical point of view. So it provides not only a dopant mechanism to subtract electrons from the polymer backbone, but additionally, it adds Li ions to the matrix. So this is why we used to call this dopant as a mixed electron ion transport provider. So it provides Li ion, and the anion plays a role of subtraction in electrons from the main backbone of the polymer. I would call only dopant because I don't want to spend too much time saying the precisely name of the particular species. We are going to combine this theoretical results with some experimental findings performed in our laboratory. So all the calculations that we are going to present here are resumed in this slide. For the small cluster or oligomer simulation, we are going to use Gaussian 09 with this characteristic for the optimization, and particularly for getting Raman spectra for the vibration analysis. For the Bull system, for example, for the description of the crystalline and amorphous PTH3 with dopants, we are going to use VASP in a conventional approach. And we are performing in parallel classical molecular dynamics using LAMMPS. I will go into details for a particular part of the talk related with the methodology applied to this use. And more recently, very demanding, but very useful and very important for us, is to perform ab initio molecular dynamics on the basis of VASP. So as you know, perform ab initio molecular dynamics is highly demanding because we need too many frames, too many snapshots of our particular system. And particularly when dealing with molecular dynamics, you have to establish a time step for the time evolution of the system. But this time step needs to be sufficient to describe all the relevant structural features of your system. For example, we are having here carbon and hydrogen. So there are carbon-hydrogen bonds, CH bonds. CH bonds vibrates in a fashion in which its frequency is located at 3,000 centimeters minus one. So this motion is very quick. So we don't have, we don't allow it to perform a time step very long. We need to describe precisely the vibration of carbon and H hydrogens. So that is the reason why our time steps are really small, 0.1 femtoseconds, in order to properly describe, for example, the vibration, the carbon H vibrations. If we're dealing with other systems with highly mass atoms, so frequency involves a really low in frequency. So in this situation, we can use time steps a little bit longer. But due to the nature of our chemical elements present in the presence of our simulation, we are avoided to go to longer time steps. So this is the reason why when we compare the final times involved in classical molecular dynamics, 500 picoseconds is relatively high in comparison. We are going longer time involved in our simulation in ab initio molecular dynamic simulation. It is 5 picoseconds. This calculation was done in a high in HPC computers in Sweden. It's very demanding, many cores per hour. So it is not possible to go further than that. So in reference to this first part of the presentation, the first part of the work was to analyze different positions for our dopants, this complex molecule. This is Li ion, this is the anion of the dopant, and this is a main change of the P3HT molecule, polythiophene. In different situations, we further confirm that the best situation from an energetical point of view is the position of the anion in parallel to the axial change of the pivot. So Li ion far from the main change of the backbone, and the anion located in parallel to the axial groups of the PHGS3. They are more or less similar in energy, but the most relevant or the most favorable configuration is the one selected by us. After that, and after getting experimental X-ray diffraction patterns, measuring the width of these peaks, you can establish a crystalline size domain for this particular system. So we dealing with our classical molecular dynamics, we will a supercell, atomistic supercell, only atom positions with the size of the crystalline size domain. And for this supercell with too many atoms, for example, 3000, not for ab initio calculation, just for modeling the X-ray diffraction pattern, we enter in a logistic of the Debye expression. Debye expression is a very convenient way to determine X-ray diffraction patterns because it neglects the use of symmetry or it neglects the use of unit cells. You put all your atoms, many atoms, and the intensity of the X-ray diffraction pattern can be determined if it becomes atom pairs. Following this expression, this is the factor structure for atom A and atom B and distances between them, and we finally get the X-ray diffraction pattern. So neglecting the unit cell, using a big model, atomistic model with many atoms, with the size of the crystalline size domain in accordance and concordance with the experimental finding, you can get these simulations that is presented in the bottom part of the presentation. So one important aspect to see, this is an X-ray diffraction pattern of the polymer. A polymer is not amorphous. It has, as I mentioned before, a crystalline regions that provides the coherence marked by these peaks, and other parts of the diffraction pattern that is a consequence of the amorphous regions. But one important aspect to mention is after the addition of these dopants, there are three peaks that appear in the diffraction pattern. These three peaks is not do not correspond to the crystal salt that provides this dopant. So the main question that could arise, this is the salt that you are using to dissolve in the matrix of your system. So you are seeing the peaks of your crystalline salt that was added to your system. And this is not the case because the peaks, the X-ray diffraction peaks for these salts do not correspond to these positions. But if we use our model after molecular dynamics and final optimization, and we calculate, when calculating our X-ray diffraction patterns, we obtain some of these features that appear in the simulated pattern. So the reason of the appearance of these peaks, it's attributable to the presence of the additives in a regular way in the middle of the change of the axial groups. So it provides a sufficient scattering power to enhance this signal, which is low or neglected in the presence of the free polymer. But after its addition, it provides a strong enhancement of some particular structural factors from X-ray diffraction pattern and enhance this signal. So with a very, very simple model, we could explain some of the peaks that appear after doping. So this is a consequence of the doping of the system. After that, we enter in a logic way of determining an amorphous phase. We build a really high higher unit cell. Now working with lamps for the classical molecular dynamics, we first apply it above with a temperature of 800 Kelvin, in order to erase any structural features or history of our system. And then we enter in a sequence of temperature reduction. After that, 500 Kelvin MD calculation. And finally, at low global temperature, low temperature, room temperature, calculation for the MDA dynamics, and finally the optimization. After that, we get a really amorphous situation in which we lost any of our coherence expected or seen in our crystalline model. And again, performing a supercell or calculating a supercell with the size of the original crystal size domain that I mentioned before, and calculated the X-ray diffraction pattern for this amorphous situation, we get this situation. That provides a very broad region with this in concordance with the use called ALO, is the signal coming from the amorphous region of the polymer that's highly reversible. One important thing to mention is that the addition of the dopant in the situation of the amorphous case, the dopant is more prone to be located close to the backbone of the polymer. This is something that was not possible in the case of the crystal. In the case of the crystalline system, as I mentioned before, if due to the energy or the energetic behavior of the system, this is the most favorable position for the dopant in the crystalline system. But when dealing with the situation of the amorphous case, what we see is too many distortions of the backbone, of the main backbone of the polymer, but the anion of the dopant agent is quite close to the situation. So there are some, in principle, the dopant could be located close to the TFN, it is an important distortion, and consequently, the loss of short range coherence. After that, we're trying to start to understanding the role of the doping mechanism upon doping, explicit doping of the main chain of our system. We started with our local capacity to perform this kind of calculation because of the amount of atoms involved in the simulations. So we decided in the first stage of this work to perform a cut of atoms. So our exil groups, it's a long chain of carbon atoms, were replaced for one methyl group. This is our first approach. And we did only one change, one dimensional change, and added our explicit dopant selected for this work. So once again, entering the dynamics in which for different positions of the doping agent in relationship to the direction of the backbone of the polymer, we see that many of the configurations that we selected are favorable for interaction, but particularly the one in which, if it is the direction of the backbone of the polymer, a perpendicular disposition upside of the polymer is the most favorable situation. We are now going to enter into details about the charge mobility of due to this absorption or interaction configuration. When the molecule or the dopant is far from the backbone, there is a small, due to the van der Waal interaction, or a small ionic contribution to this interaction, but favorable at the end. So we analyzed the charge transfer of the system, for example, applying energy charge density differences, in which we have our complete system, and we subtract the dopant alone and the polymer alone in order to see how is the charge mobility in the system upon this interaction. What we can see here is that due to the proximity of our dopant agent, in particular our anion, these are sulfonyl groups, they are responsible of the charge subtraction of the main backbone. It removes electron from carbon atom from the polycyphen. This coming from this carbon to the anion. And particularly, we found something that was that will be discussed further, but this is the first time in which we present these results. Li ion atoms is not totally free to move. It likes to establish a pi Li ion interaction pointing towards the main change of the polymer being anchored. So in principle, this site is interesting for doping our polymer and for releasing lithium to our polymeric matrix in order to have the mixed electronic and ionic contribution to the conductivity of this polymer, as I mentioned before. But what we are observing in this situation is the Li ion atom is not very free to move because it becomes trapped to this kind of interaction with the main backbone of the polymer. So the final position is relatively fixed in comparison to other situations. This charge transfer mechanism that is evidenced due to this approximation can be easily tracked by following the structural changes in our system, because if you are removing one electron for our polymer backbone, we are removing electrons, we are relatively unstabilizing our system, we will find an increase of our carbon-carbon atom system. So we can track where which of the carbon atoms lost some charges, if the bond or average carbon-carbon bond distance become increased. So tracking distance, we can get the right position of the atom that lost his electron. So this is something that we have done for many, many, many situations, confirming that the situations in which the most increase of the carbon-carbon atom corresponds to the situation in which the loss of the electron is more pronounced. It can be done for all the situation, but what is usually seen in our situation that the pi and Li established bond seems to be blocking the Li ion transport in all the situations that we observe here. So as a resume of these results, what we are obtaining here is the remotion of the electron from the carbon backbone due to this part of the doping, the dopant, because of the anion, while Li, lithium, is pointing toward the main chain of the backbone. So the anchoring mechanism, this is something that is confirmed in all the situations that we calculated. So I'm going to go a little bit fast in this way. We decided to go further with the characterization because our experimental finding performed Raman spectroscopy with two excitation wavelengths. In this case, we are using a green laser, 532 nanometers, that provides a resonant Raman spectroscopy because this polymer absorbs in this region, in the visible region of the electromagnetic spectrum. So when you are performing Raman with a wavelength which is proximate to the main band for the charge transfer of the optical measurement, you can have or obtain an enhancement of the Raman signal. It is called resonant Raman spectroscopy. And we perform the same characterization, but using another laser excitation wavelength. In this case, it's a near infrared laser that is not sufficient to be proximate to the main band for the UVB's absorption. So that is why it is called off resonant Raman spectroscopy. So this is the reason why there are some differences between them. Some signal becomes enhanced due to the resonant procedure in the system. So in order to see if our models or our simplified model went in concordance with these results, we performed the smallest calculation in this world with Gaussian for an oligomer. These are three C of N units, simplified units without exil, but only with methyl groups substitutions. And we removed our dopants because of the size of the dopants, and we put a chlorine in order to simulate the dopination. And what we observe is something that is obvious, but it's important to be confirmed by the experiment. When removing the excess electron of the main chain of the polymer, so the stretching bond going toward lower numbers because we are making not very strong our carbon-carbon atoms because of the removal of the electron of the system. So we are having a redshift of our frequencies. And this is something that is confirmed in all the situations that we perform. Additionally, there are some many features that appear in the low wave number regions that are consequences of the reestablished bonds in our polysilicon system because of the charge subtraction. So in general, there is a good correspondence between the structural changes that are observed due to the charge subtraction of the main polymer change due to the presence of the explicit dopamination of the system. So as a first summary, partial conclusion of this part of the work, our dopant agent is mostly located at the non-crystalline region. This is the most favorable position for it. It can establish a strong P-Li-ion chemical bond, as strong to enable the free ion mobility for the lithium. This is the reason why we are mentioning that this interaction is relevant. It makes not possible to put Li-ion sufficiently free to contribute to the Li-ion diffusion consequently. Our dopant is an electronic acceptor, as we saw. Only when proximate to TFN, this is what we observe here, if when being far from the main chain of the polymer, the doping situation is not very favorable. There are no very relevant changes in the charge of the carbon atom becoming part of the main backbone of the polymer. The effective doping occurs when this explicit dopant becomes proximal to the main charge. This is something that is that's highly important to mention. There is a good correlation between theory and experiment,
Ricardo,
evidenced by X-ray diffraction.
Sí, Ricardo, yes? Five last minute.
Okay. Quasi-pure electron transport mechanism is confirmed, and there is something that this was not mentioned in the presentation, but it was accompanied by electrochemical impedance spectroscopy, in which there is a practically neglected contribution from the electron, from the ionic contribution, sorry, as a purely electron transport mechanism. And this is in good correlation with our findings due to the Li-ion anchoring mechanism in the main backbone of the polymer. These results are part of this work that was published last year. I'm going to go a little bit more faster in this way. It motivates a second part of this kind of situation, in this case for a crystalline polymer with our main doping agent, and additionally adding an additive that will provide more mobility of our particular carbon change of our mobility. And the idea of this work is to try to go further in the characterization and to get some relevant energetics and charge transfer parameters in order to determine theoretically, for example, Li-ion diffusions, autodiffusion coefficients, mobilities, and to calculate the conductivities of the system. These are really complex and very difficult to do, but we decided to go to this work. So we decided to start with ab initio molecular dynamics for the first step in order to check that our conventional molecular dynamics with LAMMPS were in the same way. We cannot use conventional molecular dynamics to get this kind of analysis of the charge transfer mechanism. We can use classical molecular dynamics, for example, for getting proper structural features. But from the electronic structure point of view, there is no any relevant information that can be obtained from conventional molecular dynamics. So we decided to perform higher supercells, incorporate these additives, incorporate this, our doping agent, and here we are is just a comparison between our ab initio molecular dynamics. This is this part, this time of the situation, in comparison to our long time classical molecular dynamics. The good news is there is a good correlation, at least at the structural point of view, between conventional molecular dynamics and ab initio molecular dynamics. But we are using our models obtained from ab initio molecular dynamics to extract other further information for the determination of the main parameters for the electron transfer processes. So from mean square displacement, the cell diffusion coefficient following the Einstein formula, we can get the cell diffusion autodiffusion coefficients for the cation and the anion. This is something that is reported here for different temperatures. Really high in order to accelerate the processes. We are dealing with ab initio molecular dynamics, so we have to do anything at our possibility to accelerate these processes. This is the reason why we go high in temperature, because of the times involved. So we can calculate the transference number. We can use then the Nernst-Einstein expression using the self diffusion coefficients for the cation and anion to determine the ionic conductivity of the system. So this is something that is reported here. Additionally, we are not going to enter into details, but when dealing with electron transport properties, the conventional Renius processes is not very recommendable because the energy barriers are really small in comparison to conventional Renius model or the conventional Levy model, in which electron transport can be separated first in electron transport with no change in the nuclear motions, and then followed by a total relaxation of the environment, solvent or polymers or a structure near the place in which the electron transfer takes place. The Marcus model is the best way to describe these processes, in which the electron transfer is partially accompanied by a structural relaxation. It has a total effect of the reduction of energy barrier, in which, as can you see here, the total energy of the barrier becomes reduced because of these processes. So as soon as the electron transfer moves from one part, from the donor to the acceptor, then the system enters in a relaxation logistic, in the total energy barrier becomes lower. So we use our pictures for different situations to determine the energetics in all these kinds of situations, to determine all the parameters followed for the semi-classical Marcus theory that finally allows us to obtain, for example, our rates, in with our rates, our carrier's mobility. So we are not going to enter in the details, so only just to show you that in this situation, and because of the additive, Li ion, this is the atom that I'm following with this, our mouse, is highly mobile in comparison to our first situation in which the additive was not present. And it is important to mention that the times involved in this simulation are higher in comparison to our previous one. So we analyzed the presence of the ion in different situations. The consequences of the charge transfer being evidenced due to the structural distortions due to these charge transfer processes I've mentioned before. Remember that when you are removing a charge from the main backbone, there are charge instance modification in the carbon-carbon distances, so you can measure where the charge is being removed in order to see what which of the carbon-carbon distance becomes affected. So we do that, and we analyze the charge density in for some particular situation of this movie. We are seeing a movie, we are seeing our processes, and then trying to take pictures of this and extract the structures, relax, determine some electronic, for example, affinities or dissociation energies in order to fit our model to determine the rates and main parameters. So this is the mobility of the polaron, some region in which there are a loss of electrons, and they are constantly moving along different direction. So, partial conclusion of this section, our conductivity values obtained for the procedure described above are slightly below those observed experimentally, but in relatively close agreement. Our electronic conductivity also reveal relatively high values, evidences inclusive at room temperatures. So this is something that I didn't enter into details, but I can mention in here. Orientation energy, the energy required to transfer one electron from the system to the other system with a relaxation, showed a notorious increase compared to those results in which there are no doping agents. So we are doing this in this work, including explicitly the presence of the dopants. And this is the main difference with other works in which the simulation of the dopant mechanism is because of a total remotion of atoms of electron or totalization of electrons. So we are doing all together in an atomistic full picture for this. So the role of the explicit dopant on the interchain and intrachain doping distances and the associated static and dynamic disorder effects, the mixes ionic and electronic transport. So this is some work that is actually being submitted. We had the first round of referees. In principle, we are relatively okay. Let us see. And some final remarks. The importance of the modeling for real situation. This is a very complex system. This is something that I will particularly emphasize the role of Dominic and Mariano, because I came from the school of small system, more crystalline. So we are entering in a world that is relatively more complex, but very, very interesting to analyze. And they have all the impetu and ganas to follow, go further in order to use this kind of methodology to extract as much as possible from the structural and the electronical point of view to understand our experiment and real problem. As so, the possibility of running proper MD simulation from conventional and from magnesium molecular dynamics. Conventional can be easily tracked by aberration and molecular dynamics in order to see if everything is going in the way we expect. And after that, and taking picture, seeing the big picture, you can recover the electronic structural analysis as conventional as usually do in many other situations. So we are seeing a movie, taking frames, situation, and we extract information from these frames in order to analyze and to obtain relevant parameters to compare with your experiment or to provide new evidence for new systems. So finally, to acknowledge our group, more particularly in this case to Dominique and Mariano as part of this thesis, and Alvaro as part of this work and part of the group, and all members of the group, many of them are being connected. And thanks to you, once again, the organization, in particular, EITEL. Trabajaste un montón, EITEL, momento de jubilación y no se ha aflojado nada. Y es una parte muy importante para que este workshop siga teniendo el ímpetu que ha tenido desde siempre. Así que particularmente quiero hacer este agradecimiento en público y en español porque me sale mejor. Muchas gracias.
Bueno, muchas gracias por tu palabra, Ricardo. Ha sido un gusto hacer todo esto.
Ok. Thank you, Ricardo. Very nice job that evolved different simulation level from classical to ad initio molecular dynamics. If anyone have any question? Pueden preguntar en español.
I have a question.
Sí, adelante, Veronica.
How did you calculate this lambda energy for the Marcus model? Because I didn't, yes. I was not able to, because you
yes,
put
I don't have a much more time to go into details, but it's a little bit small. Okay. So you have to take the structure of the system in the situation in the electron is previous to the charge transfer processes, and you have to take the acceptor geometry previous to the charge transfer processes, and then you have to subtract an energy for the system and then allow to relax. It's a cross electron remotion for different situation, having the situation relaxed and not relaxed. So it's a particular procedure, very boring, very demanding, but necessary to use. And this is something that I not entered into details, but we take the pictures, we extract this particular structure, and we calculate it separately, because it was not possible. We don't find the way to do all this stuff with the complete model and with the MD simulation. So we take pictures on possible geometries for the situation in which the charge transfer occurs or not occur. And for that situation, we perform a ground state calculation, adding electron or removing electron. And with these energies that is explained here, we finally get the lambdas.
You do it with BASP, this?
Yes.
This. And yes. With you add the electron with NELECT, you change NELECT.
NELECT, exactly.
And the charge, the charge, the extra charge stays where you want? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes, in principle, yes. And this is something that is important to mention. We perform it with Gaussian too, because with Gaussian, it's a little bit more easy to put the charge when you want to put. Because you can define fragments, you can define a total charge per fragment, and you can also define the total multiplicity of the spins for the fragment. So we performed it with both, and we found some relatively good coherence between we obtained with BAS and we obtained with Gaussian.
Okay, thank you, impressive work. Ricardo.
Thanks.
Sorry, Ricardo, with Gaussian, you have classical dynamics, that's true?
Gaussian allows you to calculate classical and ab initio molecular dynamics too. So not many people use ab initio molecular dynamics with Gaussian, but it can be done. It's called AMD or OAMD. Von Oppenheimer molecular dynamics or Von Oppenheimer molecular dynamics A. Not many people use it. I think it is due to it is highly demanding. This is something that I not really mentioned into details, but when doing ab initio molecular dynamics with BASP, I lowered the energy cutoff from 500 to 400 in order to accelerate the process, because you are interested in seeing processes. You cannot use or your conventional highly precipitable condition, tolerance conditions, forgetting phone and so on. It's not possible to do that with BAS if you are interested in doing ab initio molecular dynamics. So it's a relative compromise between size of the basis and time steps and time periods for your movie, for your total molecular dynamics.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks to you.
Other question? I had one.
Yes?
Ricardo? Yes. Probably it's a technical question, but how you obtain the atomic position to describe the amorphous structure? And another question is necessary to explore different configuration?
Yes. Yes. In conventional molecular dynamics, some important recommendation is to establish replicas. You have to establish some particular situation, for example, for your dopant and your processes, and to run in parallel two or three other calculations in order to see the process that you are interested in. In this situation, I would say that it's not very relevant, but if you are, for example, trying to see new pathway, for example, for chemical reactions, this is relevant because you need to take times between no reaction to start the reaction. So you have to start from different configuration and to see if everything occurs in the same time periods. This is in general. And for the determination of our amorphous cells, I mentioned it very, very, very fast. We build a supercell and we enter in an NBT methodology. We increase the temperature and then we perform a lowing procedure with 5,000 Kelvin, for example, and then getting the cooling and until room temperature. And to check, for example, doing a calculation of the X-ray diffraction pattern is a good way to do that, or seeing the atomic power distribution is another one to see if everything is okay. This is something that in the first stage of the calculation, we didn't perform, but after some interchange with referees, they suggested that to perform as experimentally do when you are working, for example, with these polymers for doing, for example, deposition or characterization of amorphous ones, you have to heat them until some temperature and then cool down in order to erase its structural history in order to have a proper amorphous one. So with the molecular dynamics, it's the same. You need to increase the temperature and then go to lower temperature.
Okay. The last one. Have you considered a van der Waals interaction in your system?
Yes. In the case of the bus simulation, it was included with Grimet, D3. This is a cheap one.
Okay.
Semi-classical.
Another question?
Arles, antes que termine esta sesión, yo querría, voy a hablar en castellano porque todos nuestros oyentes son castellano parlantes. Bueno, te quiero agradecer tus palabras, Ricardo, con respecto a la organización. Para mí ha sido un gusto, pero yo no he estado solo. Hay mucha gente que también me ha ayudado en todo esto, que es Arles, quien está moderando hoy en día, Leo Errico, Susana Ramos y vos mismo, también que ha participado de esto. Y hoy en particular, Verónica Vildosola, que nos ha dado una gran mano guiando la primera sesión de esta charla, que ha sido una sesión muy interesante y muy buena, lo mismo que esta. Así que yo te quiero agradecer tus palabras y también agradecerte a vos de la parte de la organización en la cual has participado. Y a todos los demás que han participado en la organización. Así que muchas gracias a todos. Espero que a todos nuestros oyentes les agrade la reunión que estamos organizando y que estamos llevando a cabo. Eso, muchas gracias.
Bueno, ya que estamos hablando del tema, yo me sumo e insisto, digamos, desde el punto de vista de Ricardo Facio, que creo que el agradecimiento debe ir para usted, Eitel, que bueno, fue el que probablemente nos guió. Nosotros le hemos acompañado en todo este proyecto, pero usted ha sido el que ha llevado, digamos, la punta de todo este workshop, ¿no? Y como siempre.
Bueno, juntándonos a las 7 de la tarde, juntándonos a las 7, 7 y media de la tarde, cada 15 días los miércoles, no era fácil, ¿eh? Solo hoy te lo logra, o San Lorenzo, no sé.
Bueno, gracias. Sí.
Okay. Bueno, muchas gracias.